morning.
You know, I really enjoyed the team today. I enjoyed the praise and worship today.
You enjoy it today? It was good.
Really good. You know, even as, I pray that you really have an opportunity to experience the praise and worship, because there is so much freedom in it. Have any of you ever experienced, like, maybe you come in a little tied up, it's like going to praise and worship, you get loosened up a little bit? Any one of us, the only crazy person in the room. You know? And then after a while, you start to loosen up a little bit, you know, maybe you'll clap, maybe you'll dance, I don't know, maybe you'll shout, right? Anybody? Come on. It's good. It's very good. So, well, God bless you all. You know, this week is it's a 4th of July week, and that is why we're taking all some of the services this week. But, you know, I did want to talk a moment in regard to the holiday this week. And if you look in your bulletin, you can see that the title of today is, does anybody see it there? Yeah. Let freedom ring. Let freedom ring. Jack, I have to acknowledge you. It's very good to see you again. I was sitting over there and I saw Jack here, so God bless you. Let freedom ring. And even as we had our praise and worship this morning, I must admit, I experienced some freedom. Amen. And I thank God for it. I thank God for the freedom that it gives each and every one of us. You know, even as you come in the doors this day, may you leave changed forever as always. May you leave with freedom, strength, joy, peace. Anybody come in looking for some?
Yes.
Okay. You know, let freedom ring. Before the adoption of the Star Spangled Banner as our official national anthem in 1931, there were other anthems to our nation. One of the other anthems was entitled America. And have you ever hear of the anthem America? Anybody know the other name for America? The other name, well, the title for America is, I think it's better known for, ready? My Country, 'Tis I. All of you, oh yeah! My Country, 'Tis of Thee. And that was written in 1831, the lyrics were written in 1831, by Samuel Francis Smith. And just as a point of interest and information, it was first publicly sung on July 4th in 1831. And if those of you who know melodies, I did not know this before I read this, but the melody to My Country, 'Tis of Thee is the melody from God Save the Queen. And some of you who, or some of us who grew up in school, we used to start the school day with the Pledge of Allegiance. And My Country, 'Tis of Thee. I think there's about 13 verses to My Country, 'Tis of Thee. I know the first one. I think the first one is what we sang in school. I don't know. Well, I think, well, it's the only one I remember. But that was one of our national anthems before the Star Spangled Banner became our official anthem. And if you'll allow me, I'm going to recite the first verse, and you guys know it by heart. You can recite it with me. My country, 'tis of thee, sweet land of liberty, oh, thee I sing. Hey, we're getting weaker. Land where my fathers died, land of the pilgrims cried. I used to think that was land where the pilgrims cried. I don't think I'm that far off. But it's land of the pilgrims of pride. Give me the famous last two sentences there.
From every mountainside.
From every mountainside.
Let freedom ring.
Let freedom ring. Yeah, that's beautiful, isn't it? From every mountainside, let freedom ring. And in light of our holiday week, I do want to talk about that last portion of the verse, let freedom ring. When I hear that, the verse that comes to my mind, and perhaps your mind as well, is found in the Gospel of John, if you want to turn there. You don't have to. The Gospel of John, chapter 8, verse 32. Some of you may know what it says before you even turn there. And the verse reads, then you will know the truth, and the truth shall set you free. You know it now, right? That's John 8:32. Put it there. John 8:32. Got it. You'll forget the whole lie. But the truth, look at the scripture there, you'll never forget, neither have I. Then you will know the truth, and the truth will set you free. Now, if you'll allow me, I want to read the rest of the verses that surround that. So if you do like to turn, go ahead and stay there. John chapter 8. And let's read verses 31 through 36. To the Jews who had believed him, Jesus said, if you hold to my teaching, you are really my disciples. Then you will know the truth. You want to help me? And the truth will set you free. They answered him, we are Abraham's descendants and have never been slaves to anyone. How can you say that we shall be set free? Jesus replied, I tell you the truth. Everyone who sins is a slave to sin. Now, a slave has no permanent place in the family, but a son belongs to it forever. And you guys probably know 36 pretty well also. So if the son sets you free, yeah, you're right, you will be free indeed. Hallelujah. If the son sets you free, you will be free indeed. You know, during the course of the week, as we discussed a little bit last week, we're in our men's group, we're in the book of Titus, and of course, the ladies will be there shortly after. And in the book of Titus, although you'll find it in some of the other books as well, it talks about the bondservants. And during our discussion, we were talking about the bondservants, and then part of the discussion was, well, does it really relate to us today? Because, you know, there's really not slavery in America, although some pointed out, well, there are still some instances that there is slavery. And we were talking about the great offense of slavery and the great crime it is against humanity. But I believe that there's a greater truth in here than a physical understanding of slavery. Because even when Jesus told the children of Israel at that time, he says, I'm going to tell you the truth, and the truth is going to set you free. What did they tell him? You don't know? Yeah. They said, we're not slaves. We've never been slaves. We're descendants of Abraham. And the Lord said, you don't really know what I'm talking about. He says, I came to save all mankind from their slavery, and it was our slavery to sin and death. Sin and death. Which applied to all mankind. Right? And then the Lord went on to tell him, it's the truth that I speak into your lives. Praise the Lord. It is the truth that I speak into your lives that will set you free. It is the truth that God continually speaks into your life that sets you free. Does anybody still get set free by the truth that's spoken into your life? That's the love of God. Amen? Amen. And it's the truth that will set us all free, as Scripture said, from what holds us all captive, or has held us all captive. It was, we were held captive by the law of sin and death. Right? Praise the Lord. So Jesus came to set us all free. All right, wonderful. Wonderful, wonderful. Now, when I look in Romans 8:2, it says just that. It says, for the law of the Spirit of life in Christ Jesus has made me free from the law of sin and death. Sin and death. You see, we were all slaves to it, but the greatest freedom of all, the greatest freedom of all is given by Jesus Christ. And it is freedom from sin, death, and let me throw some other things in there. It's freedom from guilt, condemnation. I still enjoy that freedom every time I experience more and more of it. How about you? The there are still times in my life, perhaps yours as well, when I'm plagued by guilt and condemnation. It's a terrible feeling. Anybody with me on that one? Yeah, right, man. Well, one of the gifts that God gives us all is the freedom from it, and I experience it more and more through the truth that God wants me to be free from it. And I shared with you on Wednesday that sometimes our heart condemns us, you know? You ever just wake up or spend the day just feeling guilty? Sometimes you know why. Sometimes you don't know why. Sometimes your neighbor tells you why. But I know one of the truths that God speaks into my life and yours as well is, and I grab hold of it when the Lord talks to me or speaks to me, I don't have to be guilty for any reason. You know? Listen, in life we love each other, we try our best. Sometimes we fail each other. It's not because we don't love each other, we just fail each other sometimes. But be freed up from the guilt associated with it, you know? Don't live your life in guilt. Jesus Christ came to free you from that, huh? What a wonderful freedom that is. Like, it sets your spirit free. It sets your soul free. And that's greater than setting your body free. When you're free from it, then you experience all kinds of freedom. You know that to be true. You know that to be true. It's the freedom that you want to experience on the inside of you. It's like something that I felt this morning during praise and worship, you know? It was a freedom. Thank God for the freedom, huh? Let freedom ring. Let freedom ring. But you see, the greatest freedom is just that. It's the freedom from sin and from death and from guilt. Now, along with that, I want to ask and answer the question. It's something we talked about in men's Bible study, but I think we talk about it in the group here on a regular basis. And the question is this. What is sin? What is sin? And, you know, I like a few simple definitions because, I don't know, man. You know, sometimes you can say what is sin and you might come up like a million things of what sin may be, you know? Let's start with this idea. Let you name your sin and we'll go around the room. I am so sorry, Maria. That wasn't even... What are you laughing at? You're next. Let's all be open here. Now, if you were smart, you look at me and say, you first! As you leave us this morning. Because all too often we see sin as, you know, a certain act that we do that is against Scripture. But that's, as we've discussed, that's really not what sin is. It's what sin produces. Because I see that as leaves on a tree, and I can constantly, you pull one leaf out of your life, it's like, you ever conquer like one thing in your life, and if you want to look in that realm, it's like, well, gee, then I got 1,000 others. Right. Or maybe, once again, you don't see that in yourself, you see it in the one next to you. But you see, how do you answer all the questions? How do you answer all the pains and ills? What do you do with one leaf at a time? No, because that's not what sin is. That's not what sin is. I believe all those acts are a product of what sin is. But some of the basic definitions that I've enjoyed and we shared them, sin is mistaken identity. It's mistaken identity. You know, I love it that we live in a day and age today where, you know, one of the greatest crimes is identity theft. Identity theft. And I find it, you know, spiritually significant, of course. You know, because I do believe we have all lost our identity as children of God. I believe the world in general, we have lost our identity as children of God. Some of us walk this planet not even knowing that God is our Father. Some of us walk the planet thinking that half the world aren't children of God. Yeah, thank you, brother. Yeah, thank you. That's identity theft. Someone stole your identity and they stole your neighbor's identity. Yeah. But when we don't know who we are, when we don't know that we're children of God, when we don't know that we're the very essence of God, we have a divine nature. Every human being has a divine nature. His nature is inside of us. Love is inside of us. Peace is inside of us. Joy is inside of us. Where do you think you get that from? Your Father, your Creator. Yeah. Mm-hmm. So I believe when we lose our identity of who we are, it produces a lot of wrong acts. Sin also is defined in Scripture as separation. Sin is separation, and that's what we talked about in our group. Sin is separation. I love this definition because it's separation from God, because when Jesus Christ came to the earth, what did he do? He bridged the gap between mankind and God. Jesus Christ came to reconcile man to God. Sin is separation from God. And don't forget the other aspect of that, or the other half of that, because I always love the picture of the cross. The cross is both vertical and horizontal. See, the cross in heaven has everything to do with your relationship with God, but it's only half. Because it's your, that's right. It's your relationship to everybody else. So sin is not only your separation from God, sin is your separation from your neighbor. Sin is what separates us from our own body, which is everybody. And because of the separation now, because of what sin truly is, a separation, it says, I don't believe that you're my family. I just believe you're some stranger that walks the street. I have no problem stealing from you. I got no problem robbing from you, hurting from you, because you don't mean nothing to me. Until someone gives me a revelation, don't mean nothing to you, they are you. And then when I regain my identity, it's not fully asked, I follow. I'm not going to hurt you. When I hurt you, I hurt me. When I bless you, I bless you. Isn't that beautiful? So you see, freedom. The freedom, and let freedom ring. The freedom that the Lord brought to the planet is your reconciliation back to God. But sometimes that's an easy one to grasp. Sometimes the one that we don't grasp so easily, it's your reconciliation back to everyone else. And it's something we talked about on Wednesday. You don't live a life unto yourself. You cannot be free unless you live attached to everybody. And unless you're attached to everybody, you're not free. But we say, I'm free, I'm living my life. When you live your life, it's called sin, it's separation from your family. Isn't that so, guys? Yeah. So when Jesus Christ said that he is going to set us free from the law of sin and death, the sin that he is setting us free from is our separation from God. Know how much he loves you. And sometimes you need to know this. You need to know how much you love him. And sometimes I need to be set free. Sometimes I do some things and I'm not set free. I can't tell Jesus that I love him because I feel guilty. There we go again, right? I know you don't know what I'm talking about. Sometimes I feel guilty and I can't talk to God because I think I did something wrong. I think I'm a rotten bum that day. I'm sorry. Yeah, man. But then when the Lord sets me free from my sin, it allows me from the inside of me to cry out to my God, whom I love. And sometimes it just breaks out of you. Doesn't it just break out of you sometimes? Like it's been restrained for too long. And you say, but Lord, I love you. I know that I love you. I know that you're good. I know that I want you and desire you. And in that moment of expression, it breaks the bondages off your life. Off your mind, off your soul. Amen? Amen. Yeah! Yeah! And then let that give you the freedom to go and help somebody else. let it eliminate the separation between you and your neighbor. We're all living our criminalized at times because we don't realize that we love each other. We're connected with each other. We're each other's salvation. We're each other's joy. You know? We're each other's pleasure. What's the purpose of life? Have they asked that question? What's the joy of life? Have they asked that question? No? Okay. Look all around you. All around you. And sometimes we believe the lie. That's not my joy in life. That's my heartache in life. Now. You need to be set free from your separation. Anytime you're separated from anyone, it's sin. Sin is separation. You don't know that you're connected to everybody around you. Isn't that beautiful? Amen. So what is sin? You know, Proverbs 18:1 is a verse that intrigues me. It says, through desire, a man having separated himself. I think it applies so much to our culture today. A man having separated himself seeketh and intermeddleth with all wisdom. I think in essence is what it's saying is this. Through desire, a man having separated himself. Long and short of it, don't separate yourself. Because sin is separation. Don't separate yourself from your friends, from your neighbors, from your coworkers, as if, well, you're just two different people. You're the same person. You guys with me?
Amen.
the freedom and everything that you desire in life. You know, every question that you have, every groan inside you that you have, is going to be answered with the elimination of sin. It's going to be answered with the elimination of your separation from God and from each other. I know sometimes you think the world is our problem, but that's just a lie. We don't realize the world is your salvation, man. Huh, come on now. Our culture just lives in our own world. It's all about me and my world. I got to take care of my world. That world is called a separated world. It's called a sinful world. It's called a world not knowing who you are. And sometimes we even get caught up with the families. Okay, God bless the family, but realize this. We are all the family of God. We're all the family of God. So if you're tempted to say it's just me and my family, well, that incorporates everybody then. I'm in agreement with you. I only have time for my family today. Well, you're going to be very busy then. My family are coming over for dinner. Really? Where you all eating? Yeah. Isn't it interesting when you look into the world and you can see the separation of all mankind? You can see it in different nations. You can see it in different cliques. You can see it just in your neighbor who you think is so separated from you. But God came to restore all mankind. He came to restore us with one another. Hallelujah, huh? Isn't that wonderful? Just wonderful. So, you know, in light of the message, hey, let freedom ring. Let freedom ring. All right. Let's see. John, where we started in chapter 8, let's see what 34 and 35 says. Okay. 34, Jesus replied and said, I tell you the truth. Everyone who sins is a slave to sin. I like that. We'll get back to it. Now, a slave has no permanent place in the family. It's just what we were talking about. A slave has no permanent place in the family, but a son belongs to the family. You see, the one who is a slave to sin is the one who doesn't realize they're part of the great big family. And then it says, I want you to hear this, and I want to deliver it from really the heart of God. I want it to be said and heard from a heart of love. When you read 34, because 34 says, I tell you the truth, everyone who sins is a slave to sin. Hear this, true love. When you separate yourself from the world around you, Scripture says that you're a slave to it. It's not your freedom, it's your slavery. It's your bondage. You think you're free from everyone who gives you heartache in life, but that's not what Scripture says. Scripture says you're a slave, your sin, your separation, that's your slavery. Do you find that interesting? Because your freedom is found in regaining relationships with everybody. I find that so extraordinary, I really do. And sometimes we just want to be so isolated in our lives because of so many crazy thoughts. But in our isolation, in our own lives, we become a slave to it. Now, don't tell me this isn't true. There are some times when you're stuck alone and you know what? And there are times, I don't want to be alone. How'd I get here? Right? Sometimes we're a slave to our separation. And then we say, well, where's the joy? I'll tell you where the joy is. It's everyone we cut out of our life. Well, what do we do? Ain't no problem. You know there ain't no problem. Jesus Christ came to set you free. You shall know the truth. What's the truth going to do to you? Yeah, the truth is going to make you talk to your neighbor. Interesting response. Three somewhat agreements. Okay. All right. 35. Now, a slave has no permanent place in the family, but a son belongs to it forever. This is the freedom. I want you to see this. The freedom is found in knowing that we are the family of God. That's where the freedom is found, knowing that we are the family of God. Knowing that God is your father and everyone around you is your brother and sister. Yeah. Now, Scripture says once he has freed us from the law of sin and death, we are now subjected to another law. But the other law is a good law because it's the law of God. Let's see. Looking at verse 36, we read 34, we read 35. Now verse 36 says this. It says, so if the Son sets you free, what's the rest of that? You're free indeed. And I believe the truth there is this. You realizing your sonship brings freedom. You realizing your adoption into the family of God brings freedom. But you realizing everybody else's adoption into the family of God brings freedom. Freedom from what? Sin. What's sin? Okay, not bad, not bad. Not bad for a Sunday morning. Yeah, that's right. The only one that can set us free is the Son. Sonship is the only thing that can set us free. You're realizing that you're part of a family, man. Yeah. Sonship and adoption. You guys know Romans 6:18? Let me read a few verses to you. Romans 6:18, it says, being then made free from sin, interesting, you become servants of righteousness. Righteousness, another word for righteousness is right standing with God. You're free to talk to God.
Amen.
Thanks, Pastor Phil. Yeah, great, great. What did he say?
Said everything is great.
Oh, did he mention any of our names?
Yes, everyone.
Listen, everybody, listen. When you're free from sin, you're free to talk to God. Come on. You're free to talk to everybody. Yeah. You're servants of righteousness. Romans 6:22. Okay. Everybody still aboard? I feel like sometimes I have to lure you or entice you by promising you a short message. I'll give you a short message if you give me your attention. We got a deal? Some of you say that's the only way you get my attention. I'll take it. I will take it. It's a short message, so give me your attention, please. Okay, Romans 6:22. But now, being made free from sin, you become not only servants of righteousness, but you're servants to God. Uh-huh. And you have your fruit unto holiness, and the end is everlasting life. Amen. 1 Corinthians chapter 9, verse 19. I like this. For though I be free from all men, yet have I made myself, does anybody know the end of that one?
Servant.
Yes, yet I have made myself servant to all. Uh-huh. Don't you love that picture? Let me finish this. That I might gain them all. Uh-huh. The one who is truly free, the one who is truly free is the one who is free to serve others, to help others. The one who is truly free is the one who's able, are you with me, guys?
Amen.
Is the one who's able to lay their life down for somebody else. The one who is truly free doesn't have to hold on to their life as if that's the only important life on the planet. I got no time for your life. My life is preeminent. I'll get to you if I get to you. But the one who is truly free is able to give their life to all. Your life is to give to others. Give somebody something.
Amen.
If there's nobody around, go look for someone. Go on a hunt. What can I give you? Can I give you some of my time this morning? I have a free afternoon. Who can I give my afternoon to? How about me? No, wrong answer. No. The one who, come on now, I'm joking with you, but you know what I'm saying. The one who is truly free. The one who has truly been free from all kinds of sin and separation is the one that's free to just live their life for the world. And you live your life for God, you live your life for each other. My needs are fine. I'm fine. God took care of me. God took care of you. Matter of fact, the only way I'm going to find joy is not locked up in my house. The only way I'm going to find joy is if I find one of you guys.
Yeah.
Hey! And you do often. The only way you're going to find peace, inspiration, hope in this life is when you bust out of your life and touch somebody else's life. I can't tell you how many times I experienced that. Haven't you? Haven't you? Yeah. Sometimes I have no inspiration for a message. I gotta lock myself up. I need a message. There's nothing in my hole in my wall. There's nothing in there. So I leave that place and I talk to a few people. And sometimes God will orchestrate it. Like, you sit down and do something and all of a sudden 20 people have entered the room. One at a time, of course. And there's no time for a lesson. The Lord says everyone who walked in your room was your lesson. Your inspiration. Uh-huh. Your life. We get so locked up with what we got to do. And I've become separated from who I really am. The world slow down just a notch if it may. And let us touch each other. Let sin be removed from your life and my life forever. What is sin?
Separation.
God bless you. God bless you. Let sin be removed from my life forever. Uh-huh. Let me find my freedom. Where?
In
God and each other. Or you know, it's just the God and you. Nothing wrong with that, right? Yeah, nothing wrong with that. Yeah. Okay, great. All right. Let's see. I do have a couple more verses, although I promised Rick. Mark 10:44 says this, and whoever of you desires to be the first, anybody have a desire to be the first? Don't answer. Let him be the servant or the slave to how many?
To all.
Don't live your life unto yourself, live it unto all. Do you guys enjoy hearing that? Do you want to do that? Because I find some freedom there. I find some truth there. I find some real life there. Thank you again. What did God say? What else did he say this morning?
I can't tell you.
What, talk to yourself, you said? Talk to yourself. Very good. Very good. Galatians 4, chapter 4, verses 4 through 5. It says this. But when the fullness of time had come, God sent forth his son, born of a woman, born under the law, to redeem those who were born under the law, that we might receive the adoption of sons. Amen. I want us to see again and again that our freedom from sin and death is found in our sonship, our adoption, our understanding, our father and our family. Beautiful, huh? And the whole world of religion itself, all religion does, religion and anything man-made, it constantly divides. Divides. It says, my nation is better than your nation. My company is better than your company. My family is better than your family. I'm better than you. I'm smarter than you. I'm stronger than you. I'm richer than you. Anyone in that hit? Yeah. And God came to deliver us all from that sin called separation and realized, Tony, you and I had a great conversation today, realized our equality, and our equality is found in our oneness, but it's not on a low level. Sometimes we in false humility, we find our equality on a low level, and we say, hey, we're all sinners. Hey, you're rotten, I'm rotten, we're all the same. Okay, all right. Well, you're rotten, yes. No. And I say, the answer is found not in, our quality is not in a low place. Our quality is in a very high place. The truth of the matter is, though, you're rotten. You're wonderful, and I'm wonderful. You're smart and I'm smart. You're rich and I'm rich. You're great and I'm great. You're holy and I'm holy. You're God's and I'm God's. And I find our quality is not found in a low place, but a high place. Yeah. Uh-huh. If I'm a child, you're a child. What's the difference? Is there any difference in the family?
No.
Thank you from the seas of fall. No difference. Okay. So you can see, once again, I want you to see this simple, powerful truth that our redemption from freedom from sin is found in the adoption as sons and daughters. It's getting back into the family again. It's realizing our equality, which is all found in a high place. Don't you love that? That's why when someone comes up to you and me and tells me how rotten they are, I have to look at them and tell them, you can't be rotten because then I'm rotten. And I can't accept that. Or if I want to say I'm rotten, I can't say I'm rotten because I don't believe that you're rotten. Uh-huh. And our quality is not found in a low place, but a high place. Yeah. See, this is the message of heaven. This is not an earthly message, and you know it. This is not a man-made message. Because man sees natural things that would want to defy the things of God. But the things of God are so much higher than the things of man. The vision of God is so much greater than the vision of man. How about this? The goodness of God is so much greater than the goodness of man. Uh-huh. And let us find our equality there. Uh-huh. You You know, Romans 8:23, I will end with this passage here. Romans 8:23, it says that we are eagerly. When Scripture says that there are groans inside of you and me, anyone ever experienced some groans inside of you? God bless you all. God bless you all. But the essence of our groan that's inside of us is Scripture tells us this. It's with us waiting for our adoption. Not our personal adoption, but it says we're waiting for the adoption. It says we're waiting for the redemption of our body. Not this body. You tired of just taking care of this body?
Yeah.
It's waiting for the adoption. Well, I want it to be a greater picture. It's waiting for the adoption of this body.
Amen.
I want to take care of this body. The groan inside of me is for the redemption of this time, that we may be whole. Stop looking at me, me, me. The groan inside of me truly is for me. Right? Why don't you all stand with me? And I'll ask the praise team to come forward. Have you all selected a song to close with at all? You got. Today is a day. Okay, today is a day. The one who is truly free, the one who is truly free, let freedom ring. The one who is truly free is the one who is servant to all. But note this, that word servant, it's not necessarily in a subservient kind of a way. The one who is servant of all is just the one who realizes that you're connected to everybody around you. That the person's life next to you is the same as your life. We belong to each other. Uh-huh. Amen. Let freedom ring. Praise the Lord.
Amen.